going to sing tonight. Rejoice in the Lord. Let us rise. Okay. Time of praise and worship and rejoicing in the Lord. Maybe Brother Keith will just lead us to the Lord in prayer tonight. Lovely to see you here, and if you're visiting with us, we give you a special word of welcome tonight. There is a cup of tea after the meeting, so don't be in any rush away. The new building out the back will be open as well, and you're more than welcome to have a look around there as well in the building project. Keith, you just lead us to the Lord, and then we'll proceed with the meeting.
Give thee thanks once again for another Lord's Day, where we can come into thine house and to lift and to glorify and to praise thy great name. We thank you for the man at thy right hand, the Saviour, our blessed kinsman redeemer. And Lord, we uplift and glorify thy great name. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for the very access once again that we, thy good bought children, have to enter right into the very holy of holies. And Lord, we have come, Lord, to praise thy great name. Whosoever offereth praise glorifieth me. And Lord, we hear, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that for this Resurrection Sunday, where we can come and we can say that he is risen. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, that the tomb this very night is empty and the throne room is occupied. We thank you, Lord, that the one that once was crowned with thorns is now crowned in glory. Lord, we worship thee in spirit and in truth. Lord, we'll be like John of old there in the Isle of Patmos, where they could say, I was in the spirit on the Lord's day. Lord, we pray, dear Heavenly Father, for a deep sense of thy divine presence. We pray that the third person of the divine Trinity, God the Holy Spirit, would come and fresh tonight and bless. And Lord, that thou would move in a mighty way. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, that thou would do the work which only thou could do. We ask, dear Heavenly Father, tonight that thou would draw people to the King's Son. May this be a night of rejoicing, not only in earth but in heaven, of some poor soul or souls coming to repentance towards God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for each child of thine that's gathered tonight. But Lord, we're mindful for those that know not Christ. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, that thou would come in a mighty way, that thou would pour out thy spirit, that Christ would be manifested tonight. Lord, we ask as we lift our voices to thee, Lord, that thou would come and bless us. Lord, we thank you that we can say like the psalmist, my lips shall greatly rejoice when I sing unto thee, and my soul which thou hast redeemed. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, tonight that we're standing in redemption ground. We thank thee, Father, tonight for the precious blood of the Lamb. Lord, we're never weary of singing about the blood. We're never weary about singing about the Lamb. And Lord, as we lift our voices on today, tonight, Lord, we've come, Lord, to glorify thee. Help everyone in this meeting tonight to leave this house rejoicing. May we be able to say, Lord, like those two disciples on the Emmaus Road, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked with us by the way and open unto us the scriptures. Lord, have the glory tonight. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, tonight for the triune Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, tonight for God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Lord, as we lift our voices unto thee, draw near. Lord, we're mindful tonight of every preaching house right throughout this land. We ask that thou would give liberty in the Spirit, as men lift up the book and preach Christ and Christ crucified. Lord, bless us now, Lord. Close us in with thyself. Drive back the enemy in every power of hell. And Lord, we'll be very careful to give thee all the honour and all the glory and all God's people said. Amen.
Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask Colette now to come. And Rachel, we are here to praise the Lord tonight. We're here to worship in the Lord. We had a blessed time this morning, praising the Lord and the Word of God this morning. That's what we want to carry on with tonight. And so we've got quite a few people taking part tonight. And then there will be a cup of tea after the meeting as well. So don't be in any rush away. There is no prayer meeting tomorrow night, but there is a prayer meeting Wednesday night at 8 p.m. And you're more than welcome to come along. And then next Sunday morning, God willing, at 11 a.m. is the ministry of the word. And I will be responsible for that. And then next Sunday evening at 7 p.m. again, our brother Alan Barkley will be here. So it'll be lovely to have you back again next Lord's Day evening. Tell others about the meeting. Get excited about the things of God. And if the resurrection means anything, it means victory. It means victory. And so that's what we want to claim even in the meeting tonight. Now, Colette, come on ahead and sing for us.
Hello, everybody. The song that we're going to sing is called the Old Country Church. And, well, we're a bit sick of hearing what the church used to be like and how it used to be in fire and it used to be full. And we decided that we're going to bring the Old Country Church here to the Lifeboat tonight. So there's a few verses, and you might recognize them. And if you do, you have to join in. Yeah, it'd be rude not to join in with us tonight. So join in, clap your hands, shout hallelujah. Anything goes with this song.
We don't normally sing together, no. And we're mother and daughter in case you think we're sisters.
So we don't know what way this is going to go, but anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to go back to that old country church to hear the songs of praise. How the people would sing, it would make the rafters ring at that old country church.
Colette was saying about being mistaken for being Rachel's daughter, our sister. Whenever I was in seeing Catherine the other day, the nurse turned around and said, "Are you her husband?" So, and then she kind of sent me a message that night. She says, "I doubt you need to get a facelift." So there you go. Amen. Go on ahead, Ruth.
I don't know if I'd want Stephen Riddell as my dad, Alex, but
just sing.
Is a current of
Beyond. just beyond the river.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. There's another chorus I want you to sing. It's not in the chorus book, and it's not in the hymn book tonight, because there's a lady, a very special lady here tonight, and it's her birthday, and that's Pat Johnson. Pat, we've got some flowers for you at the back. Maybe Adrian will go and get them. Want us all maybe sing happy birthday to Pat tonight? And Pat has been a blessing, and she is a blessing. Every time she comes through those doors, she never complains. She's always smiling. And so there's a little gift. I said to Adrian this morning, my mother was laughing. Adrian came in the back. I says, Adrian, there's flowers in the pulpit. You'll need to go and move them. And Adrian went and he moved these. And he said to me, Pat will never be able to lift them. I said, leave him back and get the ones in the pulpit. So he has the ones there at the moment. So maybe we'll sing happy birthday and Adrian can give those to her sister Pat. Maybe someone will lead us out.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Pat. Happy birthday to you.
We can give her the bumps later on. Amen. We're going to stand to our feet and we're going to sing 205. 205 in the chorus book. When my life's work is ended and I cross the swelling tide, when the bright and glorious morning I shall see, I shall know my Redeemer when I reach the other side, and his smile shall be the first to welcome me. 205 in the chorus book. We'll rise to our feet and then the young people will come and sing two pieces for us tonight. Amen.
I shall know my Redeemer when I reach the other
Going to sing is Victory in Jesus, so it'd be really lovely if you could all join us in the chorus.
Gave his life on Calvary to
Amen. Praise the Lord. There's a wonderful group of young people here. They're out in the Moy the other day in the open air. And you pray for them. They've been a blessing to us here. I'm going to ask Colette to come along and sing another piece to us this afternoon. And do take these young people on your heart and pray for them. They are the next generation. Lovely to see them out doing the doors. Lovely to see them taking part in the prayer meeting. Most prayer meetings are here. And so that is contagious, you know. There's a lovely group of them here on a Friday evening, just settling down around the word of the Lord. And if you can take them on your heart, I know Colette's sort of growing out of that age, but you can pray for her too. So, amen. Come on, Colette.
Cheeky. This will be a piece I'd like to try. I haven't sang this piece in 30-odd years. And I just thought, you know, when you're sitting down there, you get so nervous. But, you know, I just thank God for the cross. Amen. And I thank him for all that he's done in my life. Praise his name.
Let me turn my eyes to that place called Calvary. There on a hill, Jesus suffered for me, bearing my shame as he hung on the cross, giving me life at his deep. There, Lord, they placed a crown of thorns on your head. There, Lord, they pierced your precious hands and your feet. There, Lord, they spat and mocked your holy name. There, Lord, you died because you loved me. But 3 days later, oh, you rose from the dead. Death has no victory, grave has no sting. Now you are seated at God's right hand. Jesus, my Savior, my Lord and my
to sing tonight is her sister Rachel here, and then we're going to open the word of the Lord. Amen. Thank you.
The last song that I'm going to sing brings you through the Easter story, and there's nothing that I can ever add to the Easter story other than a hallelujah. And I know I've been up and down here like a yo-yo, and I've been getting used to clap and sing along and everything, but for this one, I'd really just like you just to listen to the words and just allow the song to bring you through the Easter story.
A
crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before us. Hallelujah! 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 He hung his head and prepared to die. Then lifted his face up to the sky, said, "I am coming home now, Father, to you." A reed which held his final sip was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave his soul to glory. From his head the thorny crown, and wrapped him in a linen gown, and laid him down to rest inside the tomb. The holes in his hands, his feet and side, now in our hearts we know he died to save us from ourselves. Oh, hallelujah! 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 3 days went by, again they came to move the stone, to bless the slain with oil and spice anointing. Hallelujah! But as they went to move the stone, they saw that they were not alone, but Jesus Christ has risen. Hallelujah!
Lord, one of the most unique things about the Lord whenever he was here was the way that he communicated to people. On one occasion, the temple police were sent to arrest him, and whenever they came back later on to the Pharisees that had sent them, they came and they said to them, "Never man spake like this man. He was the greatest man that ever lived. Sometimes he preached sermons like the Sermon on the Mount. Sometimes he preached long sermons. Sometimes he preached very short sermons. Sometimes he spoke to a vast multitude of people. Sometimes he just spoke to the individual like the woman at the well. I want to leave with you tonight three times when the Lord Jesus just said one word. One word statements from the mouth of the Lord. Whenever I was running about and whenever I wasn't saved, and one time and among many times I got in trouble with the police, they brought me into the questioning room and the sergeant said to me, all I want is a one-word answer. And I want to leave with you tonight three one-word statements of the Savior. In Matthew's Gospel, chapter 8, you don't need to turn to it. The Lord Jesus Christ has made his way across the Sea of Galilee. And as he comes across the Sea of Galilee, it is there when there's a storm arises in the sea. And as he is in the boat, the Bible tells us that he was weary and he was asleep and his head was on a pillow. It was then when the disciples woke him and said, carest thou not that we perish? And there the Son of God, with all of the power that dwelt within him, he stood on the bow of that boat in a storm like those fishermen had never seen before. And he said, peace, be still. And the very wind and the waves obeyed him. Then they came across the Sea of Galilee and they came to what we call as the land of the Gadarenes. And as he stepped off the boat and onto the shore, the Bible tells us that there was a man that saw him afar off. He was a broken man. He was a bad man. He was a bound man. He was a man that knew all about pain because he cut himself night and day. He was a man that knew all about the problems of life. He was a man that knew what it was to be possessed by the demons of hell himself. He was a helpless man. He was a homeless man. He was a hopeless man. And as he came, and the Bible says he ran to the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ, the demons started to speak out of him. He's that man that we know so well as the demonic of Gadara. These legion of demons, over 1,000 demons, they cried, what have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God? And my dear unsaved tonight, let me tell you this. You maybe say, well, I believe in God tonight. The book of James says, yea, ye do well, for the devils believe and they tremble. And the demons, what they wanted and what they always want is they want to possess a body. And they saw a multitude of swine feeding and they besought the Lord that he would cast them into the swine. Over 1,000 demons. I don't know if he was involved in the occult. I don't know what he got involved in, but he lost his family. He left his home and was relegated from society. They couldn't tame him. They couldn't chain him. They couldn't use him. They couldn't speak with him. Because these demons took control of him. And if you're not saved tonight in this meeting, let me tell you this, that it could happen the very same to you. And as these demons, they besought the Lord that he would cast them out, he just said one word to them. Go. Go. I tell you, my dear people, tonight, if that shows me anything, that shows me something of the authority of the Son of God. Go. And the very demons of hell and the powers of darkness had to acknowledge him. And they had to obey him, and they did go. And no matter who you are tonight in this meeting, and no matter how far you seem to think that you have gone, I tell you, if the Lord Jesus Christ could deliver a man that was possessed with over 1,000 demons with one word, he can deliver you tonight with one word too. Go. And my, that man, he was clothed and he sat at the feet of the Lord and he was in his right mind the power and authority of the Son of God. That's why we've called this praise meeting tonight, because there's no one like him. There's no one with the authority that he has. Go. Go. I wonder tonight, is there someone here and you know all about demonic power? I wonder, is there someone here tonight and you're tormented in your mind and maybe you've been thinking about suicide? Suicide's not only mental health. I tell you, there's a demon of suicide. Whenever you see young people cutting themselves with stones and with knives, I tell you, it's not just a matter of not getting the grades in their exams. There's an enemy behind it. And the one that said to the man of Gadara and the demons that were there, go. He can say the very same thing over your life tonight. With one word, he cleansed a leper. With one word, he raised the dead. I tell you, the authority of the Son of God. And then, of course, you remember in Matthew chapter 14. My, it was there after the feeding of the 5,000. And my, the Lord, the Bible says he constrained his disciples to get into a ship. And as they went on into the ship and they got into the sea, the Bible says that he went up onto the mountain to pray. And the disciples went out and they were going to go to the other side. And the word of God says, then a great tempest arose. And the Lord waited until the fourth watch of the night. The darkest hour of the night, the Lord was watching them up on the mountainside. And the Bible says that then he came unto them. Oh, my dear unsaved. He knew where they were. And God knows where you are tonight. And you maybe are, look like a Christian and you sound like a Christian and you know all of the verses and all of the cliches, but he knows where you are tonight because he's interested in you. And here the Lord Jesus himself came down from the mountainside, and he came to the shore of the Galilee and he put his first foot, his first step on the very wave. And he started to walk. He started to walk on the water. And my, the wind was contrary and the gale was blowing and the disciples were afraid. And the Bible says, and they saw him. Hallelujah. And he said, fear not. It is I. Be of good cheer. And of course it was Peter, that impetuous Peter. It was Vance Havner who said, and I'm not going to get into trouble for saying it tonight, but he said Vance Havner was the most Presbyterian of all of the disciples because everything that he said was almost a mistake. Now, don't take me up on that tonight. And Peter, he stood on the bow of the boat and he looked out and he thought it was a ghost. And Peter says, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come onto the water. And the Lord gave him one word. Come. That's a word of invitation now. And if you're here tonight and you're bound by the powers of darkness and you're still on your way to a lost sinner's hell where there's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth, where you'll not sing what we've been singing tonight, where you'll not enjoy what we've been enjoying tonight, where there's tears and there's pain and there's anguish and there's sorrow, where there's ever weeping and ever, oh, pouring out the soul. But, oh, it's too late. And here the Lord in the midst of the sea, he gives a word to the disciples, or just to Peter. He says, come. Come. And as we close this meeting tonight, it's still the very same word that he's given to you if you're not saved. Come. You'll need to come. Just come. And you know, whenever Peter got onto the side of the boat, and my, the laws of gravity would tell you, you can't walk on the water. But Peter knew this, he could trust the Lord. And maybe you're here tonight and you say, oh, I would love to be saved. I would love to be able to sing what those young people have been singing. I would love to know about victory in Jesus, my Savior forever, but oh, I feel I'm too far gone. I feel that He couldn't help me. Oh, I don't know, could I trust Him? My dear people, tonight you can trust Him. Oh, you can trust Him. Come. Just one word now. Come. Just come. Then the last one. What an event that was. My, the climax of his life. And there the Bible says, when they came to the place which is called Calvary, it was there they crucified him. It was there where they put the crown of thorns on his blessed brow. It was there where they pierced his hands and his feet, what we've been hearing tonight as our sister Rachel has been singing. It was there where they dropped the cross into its socket and every bone jolted out of its socket. And after all of that, he was made sin who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God. And Isaiah the prophet said he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquity. And after all, the wrath of God was laid upon the Son of God at Calvary, and His precious blood was shed, and the work was finished, and the price was paid. There was one word that left His lips, and it's the one word in the Greek. It's the word tetelestai, finished, paid in full. What a word. What a word, my dear people, whenever everyone else thought that there on the cross of Calvary it was defeat. The cross of Calvary is the place of the Savior's death. It's the place of Satan's defeat. It's the place of the saints' delight. It's the place of the sinner's deliverance, Calvary. And he cried, finished, paid in full. What does that mean? It's the word that an artist would use whenever he would paint on the canvas. And he would rise early in the morning and spend the hours late at night. He wouldn't eat and he wouldn't sleep. He would invest in that piece of artwork. But then there came the moment of the last stroke. Tetelestai. Nothing more to do. It's the word that the bankers would use whenever a mortgage or a debt was being paid, and the little widow would come in and pay a little penny here and my little shilling there and try to pay off the debt the best that she could. But then came the moment of the last installment, and the Greek banker, they would put the word down, tetelestai, paid in full. My dear, there's no need to come back and pay any more money. It's all been done. Paid in full. It's the word that is used again whenever the builder was building the great buildings in Rome. And my, they would build from the foundation and they would raise the pillars that we can even see today. And then there comes a moment the final stone is laid. It's the chief cornerstone and it's set on the pinnacle of the building. And that builder with trembling hands, he would lay the mortar and he would drop the stone. And the cry that would come from the top of the scaffolding there, tetelestai, it's finished, there's no more work to do. My dear unsaved tonight, you're closer to hell than you've ever been. You're closer tonight to the wrath of God than you've ever been. You're closer tonight to being damned than you've ever been. But you see the man on the cross. My, he paid a debt that I could never pay. And the Bible says the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all of our sin. There's one more and I'll give it to you. On the first day of the week, Resurrection Day today. My, you remember Mary Magdalene, that woman, and she knew all about being bound. She was possessed with 7 demons and the Lord set her free, and she so loved him that she went to the garden sepulchre before anyone else was there, and she waited, my, and she went to the sepulchre and the stone was rolled away, and she went back and she got Peter and John and they ran to the sepulchre. And Peter went in and they didn't know. And the Bible says that they went away But she stood without weeping. And she looked in again into the sepulchre and she saw the angels there. And they asked the question, "Woman, woman, why weepest thou?" And she said, "Oh, they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him." And the word of God says, "And she turned herself about and she saw a man. And supposing him to be the gardener, oh, sir, if you have taken him away, tell me where thou hast led him." And he just said one word, "Mary, Mary." And that was enough. And she looked at him and said, "Rabboni, Master, you're the one that saved me. Lord, you're the one that has delivered me. Lord, you're the one that has changed my life." And she worshipped him there. Mary. Wonder, is there a David here tonight? Wonder, is there an Emma here tonight? What's your name? And I may not know your name, but he knows your name. Do you hear him calling it now? Just one word. Go. Come. Finished. Mary. Mary, it is I. I'll tell you, my dear people, and I can say this with our brother Bertie, we're glad that we're saved. We're glad there came a moment, and he's a Fermanagh man, and God dealt with me in Fermanagh. I tell you, he's so gracious. He's so tender. In that moment, on the 22nd of February 2010, smoking my last Regal filter, there came not Mary, but Stephen. Oh, wonder of all wonders. And that was the night that I came. That was the night that I got saved. What about you tonight? You going to come? You come to him tonight. Amen. We're going to stand to our feet and sing 589. 589, let us sing of his love once again, of the love that can never decay, of the blood of the Lamb who was slain, till we praise him again in that day. Verse 2 says, "There are cleansing and healing for all who will wash in the life-giving flood. There is life everlasting and joy at the right hand of God through the blood." My dear people, that's it tonight. It's all through the blood, because of the blood that has been shed. And if you're ever going to have your sins forgiven, and if you're ever going to have peace with God, you can live in the baptismal tank all of your life. You can go to church 7 days a week. You'll need to be washed in the precious blood of the Lamb. And I trust that'll happen to you tonight. We're going to rise to your feet and sing, and then our brother Bertie is going to pray and give thanks for the refreshments. Don't be in any rush away, and we'll have a time of fellowship together tonight. 589 in the hymn book. I want you to sing it tonight. Let's give the Lord praise. If you're saved tonight, praise him. If you're not saved, get saved. Let us rejoice together.
Let us sing of his love once again, of the love that can